Good evening. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You have been so kind and so patient to wait for the starting of this wonderful celebration. As we wait for our mayor to arrive, you will be royally entertained by one of Freeport's finest. This is a fine community, and we will be hearing a world-renowned singer, Carolyn Harding, who is one of Freeport's own. So please give her a round of applause. And this is for your listening entertainment while we wait.
Well, thank you for that introduction. I don't know about the finest, but we'll get through this. How are we feeling this afternoon? Okay, that's the folks this afternoon. How are we feeling this evening? Oh. Thought I'd test the water. We're just gonna do a little something to keep you entertained while we wait. Is that okay with you? You give me a hand. When I reach for your hand, you have to give me a hand. Y'all catch that, right? Okay. Here we go. Uh-oh. That's okay. That's okay. Find your seat. That's all right. It came late. That's okay. Put your hands together for the lovely couple, ladies and gentlemen. We're gonna take you down Blues Lane. Come on. For all the blues lovers in the house, let me see you raise your hand. This is the deep blue sea.
Oh, well, she would not have known.
We're so glad to see all of you this evening, and we're very happy that you came to help us celebrate Freeport's Black History, to help us in Freeport's Black History celebration. We're here to honor people who have made contributions to our village, the heroes and sheroes of our own African-American community, and so we welcome you here this evening, And we are so pleased that you have come to help us to celebrate these wonderful people who have served our community and who continue to serve our community. We're also here to remember those that have come before us. So we ask you to enjoy the evening.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we look to you in prayer to invoke your presence upon our program this evening. We ask that you look down with favor upon Mayor Andrew Hardwick and his staff. Grant them the grace they need for the journey. Bless the organizers of this event and richly reward their efforts. Bless the gathering of celebrants who will display their gifts and talents. Bless the presenters who will educate and edify us with historical accounts of their rich and our rich heritage. Bless the individuals and families that attend this celebration, as well as the residents of the village of Freeport. May this service mark the beginning of a new day of awareness, cooperation, and progress. And finally, we receive with thanksgiving this food for the nourishment of our bodies. We pray that it be sanctified. For every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused, if it be received with the word of God and prayer. Amen.
So at this time, I'm going to introduce the mistress of ceremonies for the evening. The mistress of ceremonies is Ms. Wilma Holmes Tootle. She is a longtime resident of Freeport, very active in the community. If I started naming all of the various organizations and such that she belongs to, we might be here for a while. So we'll just suffice it to say that Sister Tootle has been an educator, a principal, a teacher, and even an advisor to the Hempstead School District. She is active in her church. She's a longtime friend. And so I can say that it gives me great pleasure to introduce the mistress of ceremonies.
Good evening, everyone. It is an honor and a privilege to me to have been asked to serve as the MC for this most wonderful celebration. As you are aware, in 1926, Dr. Carter G. Woodson established Black History Week. And in 1976, it was expanded to a month-long celebration. Each year, Dr. Woodson's organization, the Association for the Study of African American Life, establishes a theme. The theme for this year is At the Crossroads of Freedom and Equality. How appropriate, at the crossroads of freedom and equality. They chose this theme to celebrate the anniversary of two important African American turning points: the 1863 Emancipation Proclamation and the 1963 March on Washington. I would have you know that this is the fourth year that the Freeport community has made this celebration possible, and the theme for Freeport this year is community awareness. I'd like for you to think a moment and just embrace that theme, community awareness. A community, as defined by Webster's Dictionary, is a unified body of individuals. I think I should repeat that because perhaps the dictionary knows best. A community is a unified body of individuals, a people with a common interest. So I applaud each of you tonight for your attendance and your participation, because you're a part of that community. We are going to make some slight adjustments in our program, but don't you worry, it's going to be a wonderful evening. We shall now call on Ms. Barbara Solomon, to lead us in Lift Every Voice and Sing. Please stand.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the leafy skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song.
Sun of our new day begun. Let us march on till victory is won. Thank you so much. We note the presence and the participation of Ms. Barbara Solomon, who is a noted educator in the Roosevelt Public School District. Let's give her a hand. As is the custom and tradition at many African and African American ceremonies, we shall now have the libation statement by one of our own also renowned Freeporters and retired Roosevelt educator, Mrs. Patricia Cawthorn.
It is tradition to pour a libation in remembrance of the ancestors on all special occasions, and certainly tonight is such a celebration. This celebration tonight provides us with an opportunity to reflect on our African past and our American present. Let us reflect this evening, and most especially during this year of 2013. Let us reflect upon those who endured the Middle Passage, suffered through the degradation and humiliation of slavery. We remember them now during this 150th anniversary of the Emancipation Proclamation. Let us reflect upon the 100th birthday of Rosa Parks as we all leave and purchase a postal stamp that has been named in her honor. Let us reflect upon Harriet Tubman as we remember 100 years of her transition. Let us reflect upon the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington this August. An African proverb tells us, it tells us that people who lack knowledge of their past are like a tree without roots. So, in the spirit of remembrance, let us reflect, and as we reflect this evening, we will each remember someone that was very special to us that have already made their transition. May we always remember those who have gone before us. May their lives continuously remind us that people are more important than possessions. That principle is more important than power. May whatever we do, that it is shaped and molded each and every day by honesty, competence, and commitment. We pour. May our children and our children's children carry truth, go forth with pride, and the nobility of our history and our great tradition. Asante. We remember.
While this evening will be one of cultural celebration, it will also be one of knowledge and education. So as we go throughout the evening and you are given bits and pieces of African cultural traditions, we hope that it will be enlightening and you will see more so than ever the rich and beautiful diverse cultures that we have in this country and also in Freeport. Ms. Leveda Felder, another Freeporter, is coming forth to give the official welcome. We are very proud of Leveda, who is growing up to be one of our leading entrepreneurs and Christian service workers in the community.
Fourth annual Black History Celebration. This year's theme is community awareness. Your presence has enhanced our celebration, so we invite you to enjoy the gala of victory and empowerment. Thank you.
We are going to continue our program, and now is a very important part of the program, because as you see, we're at the celebration of the honorees. No person was ever honored for what he or she received. Rather, honor has been reward of what they have given. You see before you a wonderful panel of honorees who have given much to many. So I'd like for you to join me in this wonderful recognition. Now let me tell you what I mean by joining me. So far, I've not asked you to do anything, but now I shall. We want, in the spirit of community awareness, to also have community respect. And let us at Freeporters be unified in doing everything decently and in order. Our very first honoree this evening, Cheryl Pilgrim Clark Neal, please stand. Deacon William Hartwick. Zena Lieutenant, Christopher McBride,
Anna L. Muhammad, Julius Pierce, E. Reginald Pope, Ronette Walker, Dennis Warren, Reverend Raymond Williams, Scott Richardson. Earlier, I'm given to understand that Reginald Pope was not here, but he is here with us at this time. So let's give him, he's been hospitalized, let's give him a round of applause. He is here with us.
Youngest, who's been given to us by God, and I'm sure that she's my mother all over again. And in fact, 79 years ago, on this very same day, my mother was born. And along with that, one of my brothers from another mother. And it's amazing that we call one another brothers, and his mom was born on this day as well, Mr. Pablo Thomas, and you have my love as well. But the thing, and I want to say hi, Pop. Thank you, Pop, for letting me speak tonight. That's the real mayor. And to all of you, you look so beautiful. And young people, we love you. We want you to do well. Keep doing what you're doing. Stay positive. Yes, tell them we love them. Yeah. And I should tell you also that the judge had to leave us because his little one is in a dance recital tonight, so he had to jet out of here and do the right thing as a dad. And so we're so proud of our Judge Stephen Drummond, who has not let Freeport down. And to all of my staff, I love you all, I thank you, I appreciate everything that you do, and because they do everything. You know, there isn't a secondary or thirdary team that comes in, they're it. They do everything, we ought to be proud of them, and they don't make any extra money. You know, we have appointed people, and then we have people that are public servants, and there's a difference between the two. Public servants that are civil servants, they get paid overtime. Appointees do not get paid overtime. So when you see them working after hours, they're doing it for free, along with me. The mayor doesn't get any overtime. And people need to understand that. When we're out doing this, it's because it's the right thing to do, not because we're getting paid. And I certainly don't want anyone leaving here tonight without realizing that these ethnic nights that I chose to have, I did them for a couple of reasons. One, because when you have a community as diverse as Freeport is, you've got to learn how to celebrate one another. The God that we serve demands that we love one another, and you can't love somebody you don't even know. So it's important that we lift one another up. And by doing that, we can get rid of some of this hate and animosity that's not good. It's gonna beget hate, it's gonna beget evil, and it can destroy. Because the goodness of the God that I serve will not dwell in anything that's unclean or without love. So, we're going to move on and understand that no matter what happens, Freeport, at the end, God's going to have the last say. No matter what happens. What is important, however, is that we're doing the right thing. That we're keeping our hands clean and our thoughts clean and our actions correct. That's so important. A lot of horrible things going on here the last few weeks. People lying and conniving and trying to trick people. Just keep praying for them. Yes. Don't get caught up in the mix and do the same things that they do because it's not worth it. Because the truth of the matter is, the guy that they call the mayor doesn't have enough power to wake himself up in the morning. I myself depend on the mighty touch of God. So I'm not going to get caught up in that stuff, but we're going to live and abide by the law. I swore that I would uphold it, and we're going to make sure that everyone else that's around us is doing the same thing. That's the most important thing. Now, let's talk about some history. I told you about this lovely lady that I know that was born 79 years ago. She was born in the red dirt country of Berry, Alabama, where it's a coal mine country, about 2.5 hours outside of Birmingham, Alabama, way down in the country. I mean, there's only one bus that comes a week. Can you imagine? Still today, it's that way. And everyone knows everyone because there's only a population of about, 80 people?
But may I say something?
Uh-oh.
That face. Yeah.
Come up, Pop. Come up. You can help me with this. Seeing how he found her.
But that little place had a beautiful woman. And the first day I saw
her,
I said, good God Almighty. I said, that is a beautiful woman. I didn't know her. But I found out what church she went to when she came to Birmingham. I made my way to that church. It's taken me 3 years to get her. But I got her. I knew I loved her. When I first seen her, I said, that's mine. And I didn't stop. Like some of you guys gave up. But I knew I wanted her. I wasn't going to give up because I wasn't going to let her go. And we got married, have a beautiful family, married for 53 long years. But some people say you love your kids too much. I don't love them enough. Yeah, see that she got a little papa. You hear say that over there? That's my grandbaby. Yeah, papa up here right in my baby, but I love you. But I tell you something. When he first ran for mayor, even before, he was about 10 years old, I guess, up in the kitchen with a little microphone. And my dear wife, we were sitting down in the den, you could look up in the kitchen. She said, Andrew, one day, you're going to be the mayor of Frieda, the president of the United States. I said, oh, God. But the only thing I hate about it, my wife died before.
Thank you, Pop. You know, I had Mom for 50 years. And it wasn't until, you know, everyone has their secret place. I don't know why mine happens to be in my bathroom. But that's where I do most of my talking with God by myself. Because no one bothers you when you're in the bathroom. And I came to realize that I was being selfish because my godmother, which is Clora Higgs, that helped raise me in the spiritual word of raising, or rearing, however it's correct to say, educators. I know I'm surrounded with them tonight. She said to me, right after Mom passed, that, now Drew, it's okay to mourn, but you've got to learn to let it go because Mother won't have peace unless you can let it go. And just remember that your mother loved the Lord, and we know where she is. And then with that, I began to think, this one day in the bathroom, that I was being selfish because when I thought about my mom's story, she was born in Berry, Alabama. They call it red dirt country. So far down in the woods that there are no lights on the roads in certain areas at night. So if you're going to travel down there, everyone knows do it at daytime. And winding roads and lots of valleys. And before she was born, her father was murdered by the KKK. So in my thoughts, I begin to reflect on how it might have been for her growing up and living 73 years and not ever seeing her dad, not ever having a mother and a father. And how selfish I was being after I had her for 50 years, knowing that if she's going where her father is, she's going to see him for the first time on the other side. That's history that I celebrate tonight, knowing that even with all that pain and all the absence that she dealt with throughout her entire life, she never taught us to hate anybody. My mom always said, love everybody. You can hate their ways, but you gotta love them. And then I think about how she would feed everybody. And I would say to myself, we're not gonna ever get anything to eat because after she feeds all of them, we won't have anything. And it seems like every single time that that happened, we had more food. It's like the more she helped someone, the more we had. And we never seemed to run out. And always the next day we had leftovers. I says, I didn't see her cook that much. But the point is that I've learned that if you give God a chance and let the worldly things go, not let that hate take over your inner being, and just try and do the right thing. And she would say to me, just do right. I said, Mom, that's not always easy to do. You know, because I was a military guy. I went to the military, and the military's got a certain way of doing things. You know, and civilians don't seem to want to cooperate. You know, I'm used to saying, move it now, and seconds later, it's moved. And someone's responding, what do you want us to do next? But in the civilian world, it might get moved in the next couple of years. And I'm not accustomed to that. I'm a worker. And I didn't sign up for all the politics and the rhetoric. All I want to do is work. I get satisfaction out of helping people, getting things done, and making people happy when I can, as much as I can, because that's the greatest satisfaction, is serving. And this is all about service and not being served. And a lot of people getting this for the wrong reason. Think about how many things that we can accomplish if we would just go by the history, the bad history we've seen, and not repeat it. We'd save a lot of time and money and effort, because the truth of the matter is that time is not on our side. It's not our friend. Time is not going to wait for us regardless of whom we are. It's not waiting. Our moment is now. Yesterday you can't change, and the moments ahead of us, you can't really plan because you're not in charge. We're not in charge. So it's so important that you not get caught up. And I just want to reiterate that, because we had such a great leader in Martin Luther King for the world. Yes. Love is very powerful, Freeport. Yes, yes. Love will conquer all things. Yes. Just when you doubt it. I've learned, and I know some folks, their religion doesn't call for it, but I'll tell you what works for me. Whenever something is going wrong, I say three things. My wife can tell you what that is. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Because at the end of the day, that's all you really got. You can get cute on yourself if you want to, but I'm telling you, if you live this life long enough, there's something that's going to come your way that will make you call them. Yes. because you're going to want to try. You know how you got that toothache and you try everything when it's really getting you? You want to try anything you can find in the house to get rid of that toothache. That's the way this life is. You're going to run into something that will bend your knees. The cuteness will suddenly disappear from you. And I want to finish by saying that's exactly what Freeport's going to need to do in order to recover from Sandy. Sandy's still here. We still have thousands of homes that are in trouble. We have people that are already walking away because they don't see the help coming. People are walking away because our federal government has given the impression that they don't care. People walking away because the trust factor has gone. We that understand what it is to live by faith and not by sight, I'm begging that you begin to pray harder for Freeport. Amen. I'm saying that because I know too much as your mayor. And if we don't understand that we need to come together and save this village, or we're going to lose a very beautiful seaside community.
Yes. Yes.
You understand what I'm saying? Because man is going to let us down. I'm going to be calling for a prayer vigil in Freeport. I'm bringing all religions together. And we're going to bend our knees and ask the Almighty to bring us back because we've gone too far on our own. We've got to give people the reassurance, the sense of promise that they're not alone. We still have more than 1,000 people that can't live in their homes. While others live on the other side, don't realize that they're still going through it. I had a lady call me the other day complaining about a trash can not being put back in the right place. And she doesn't understand why it took the mayor so long to respond to her. I said, ma'am, if you only knew, I could take you for a ride in the daytime and at nighttime. And maybe you would understand that we are in the midst of the storm. Sandy is still here. And every now and then we get a super high tide that comes in. It seems like it's one of Sandy's relatives coming back for a visit. We have a long way to go, Freeport. A long way to go. So understand that there's still thousands of people that are not living in their homes. We have more than 300 homes that have not even been opened yet after the storm. For whatever reason, no one's cared to even go into the home. That means that that home is filled with what?
Mold.
Many of these places are probably finished. Understand what it would mean to us if we didn't have these places on the tax roll. This is not a time for us to get cute. We have to keep the kind of leadership in place that will do the right thing for Freeport. It's so important. And you can vote for whomever you want to. I'm not here to politic tonight. I'm here to tell you we need to get on our knees. We need to show the Almighty that we need him. Because if you're waiting for Congress or for a governor or a senator or someone to, even the president, to make it all right, you can forget that. This is a community thing, and we're gonna have to do it ourselves. We're gonna have to ensure that every dime of any money coming from anywhere is spent correctly. And we all know where it is as it's being spent. Because it's not gonna just keep coming as we need it. We can't afford to waste anything. And I want to thank God for those volunteers that have come from around the country that I met with in my office today. Religious folks that have even put their own money in and that are living in tents in some places, away from their nice, warm, comfortable homes around the country to come to help Freeport and have pledged today that they will not leave us until we're whole. That's something to be grateful for. And we're going to be celebrating them. What we're going to be doing is we're going to have a site on the Freeport website that people will be able to go to and know exactly what's going on. as far as help, what's available. And the one thing I gotta tell you is that if you're not one of those victims, please don't attempt to get what they need. You understand what I'm saying? I see people come and take things that they really don't need, things that they could help buy for someone else. It's limited. So when you take it from someone that really needs it, you're really doing a disservice. So please humble yourself and do the right thing, please. And spread that word, because I'm sure you know someone else that's done it. And I say that with love. Right now, this is crucial for us. We're going to have that website set up so they'll know on a daily basis what they have available. You got to understand, when I get phone calls from residents and they're telling me about how high the electric bill is now because their walls are gone, their ceilings are gone, they have no insulation, but they have heat inside trying to keep the pipes from freezing. The heat's going out as fast as they can build it up, so the electric and the gas and the oil bills are astronomical. So that means they've got to take money from someplace else. Because a lot of folks, even when working, you're on a fixed income. And many of us are living from paycheck to paycheck. So they're going to be without a lot. So if there's something we can help with by way of food, by way of helping them with clothing, because many of them lost everything. The folks that have one-level homes lost everything. So they still need a lot. And the insurance companies have been running people around in circles. And I'm saying this tonight because this is our history. The old history and the new history are going to mix. And I want us to be on the right side of it. This is our opportunity to show others that we're the model. We set the standard. Others should follow our suit because we're the best at it. And we already have a great record, Freeport, and we can even do better now by ensuring that our neighbors get what they need. So we're going to have a food drive here as well. I'm going to have people bring in non-perishables from all over so that we can make phone calls to those in need because they can't afford to buy their food. Because they're spending so much money on trying to keep that house from going. There are a lot of people. We still have three co-ops that are empty, and I'm talking about multiple buildings, two-story buildings, empty. I'm trying to paint a picture for you because it's not good. And that's what we've got to do to change this history. Yes. We got to be there for them. Show our compassion. And if I say we're having a food drive, bring a couple of cans, but do me a favor. Check the expiration date first. Okay, don't bring something that's 5 years old. You know, it's like you're trying to get rid of somebody. You know? Please check the dates first. You know, pasta is a good thing because it's filling. You know, whatever you can do. And as a family, a Freeport family, and I know we have friends here from outside of Freeport, and we love you. We need your help too. You know, we fed more than 20,000 people during Sandy. More than 20,000 people from all over, from as far away as Queens, the Rockaways. People heard about what Freeport had, and we turned no one away. And just like Mom, the more we fed, the more God sent. So that's what I want us to be mindful of. And I'm going to leave you like my mom would. Just do what's right. Keep your hands clean. We can do so much more with love than we can with hate. We can build a beautiful town that many people will want to live in. You think about it. The last 4 years, you've had more than 50 new or expanded businesses come to Freeport. We are meeting every day with people with real money that want to develop. In fact, just tonight, we got a phone call from a super, super high-level developer that wants to take an entire section of Freeport and redevelop it. He wants to buy out an entire section and really transform Freeport into what it can be. But we've got to have a vision. We've got to understand that change is going to be good if we do it the right way and we do it in unison. We've got to be united for the good of our home. Not everyone can leave their investment and go someplace else. We're in a crucial time period right now where we have the opportunity to really show what good people can do when they need to. And that's the history. Good night, love. Good to see you. That's the history we want to have. Now, public opinion, this room that we're in right now, some think that we should take this room and fill it up with weights and let people work out up here. I, however, think that we've got to leave it as a community room, because how many places do we have where we can come together and have a meal and celebrate and lift one another up? I think that this should always remain a community room, because you can make money any place, but to be able to sit down and embrace someone with conversation and understanding, we're running out of places that are civil to do that. And in most cases, if you go someplace, you got to share it with somebody else that's got something going on in the same room. Yeah. Or the rooms are too small. Yeah. So by a show of hands, how many people like to see it become a weight room? How many people think it should stay the way it is? Okay. I totally agree. We'll put the weights downstairs someplace. You know, because we're going to need places like this. Right now, you can tell people that we have help here. We have money coming. Freeport's been awarded a lot of money recently to help us, to help people with things like appliances. So we may be able to give a free grant of $10,000 to $20,000 that can help somebody maybe put those appliances back in the kitchen. Or maybe get the doors done, or the steps done, or get the wood put back on the floor. We got to help people in any way that we can, and we're not going to stop. I've been reassured by our president that we're going to get it done. And I think Obama, president, I should say, mayor, say president, President Barack Obama, he's done a great job, a great job. The First Lady and I had the opportunity while I was at the Conference of the U.S. Mayors to be invited to the inauguration. And we got a lot of exercise, let me tell you. But she's still smiling. She was so proud to be there. What a great day we had there in Washington. And I want to thank my wife before I sit down, because my wife has been my rock. I know that, first of all, I got to tell you, honey, I admit I'm not perfect. And I know I don't have all the answers. I don't. The only thing that I know that I have, and I said this the day that I got sworn in here 4 years ago, that I've got enough sense to call God when I need him. You know, that's all I've got. But I'll tell you something. I've learned, you know, and when I was growing up, and this is for young people, after being old enough to decide on my own if I was going to church or not, if I thought I was doing something bad, I wouldn't go to church. I'm telling you the truth, because I said, oh no, he's not going to strike me down up in there. But as I got older, I understood that that's where you should be, because the people that are there, they have the same problems you've got. Everyone's just trying to get it right. So never do that to yourself. Never think that you got to get yourself situated before you go before God. He wants you as you are. And I'm not a preacher. I'm just someone that's gone through some things. And I offer it up because I know how much time I wasted before I embraced it. And if I had had him on my side, like I got him now, Andrew could have done a whole lot better, a whole lot sooner. But I just want to tell people that because the one thing I've learned is those three words. And when you say them, when you least expect it, you feel something picking you up and sitting you upright and taking the pain away. And in the midnight hour when no one else knows that you're crying and you're hurting inside, there are so many days, if it were not for the love around me, he could take me, because when I lost my mother, I was ready to go. It's very difficult for me. I'm a mama's boy. And I have no shame in saying it. I love my mama. And wherever he has her is where I want to go. So my only prayer is that he will govern this mayor of Freeport accordingly, so when my day is done, I go home to my mama. God bless you, Freeport.
Instead of